initial dredge, good clear out. But I don't see a situation where that is then just that's it for the next 10 years. I think this is something, once you've got it, you've got it, and you've just got to keep on top of it.
Any more questions?
Thanks, Chair. I'm sorry if it bothers me, but you tell me that there's no traces of this weed in the DSRE at all.
No, there is.
So, if we were to spend an awful lot of money sorting it out in the marine, like.
Spot on. I know, I mean, it fills up with the high tides, and this is the problem. It's going to grow.
So come back to what I said previously, why would the deep authority not let us deposit the dredge with the spores, complete with the spores and dredge silt back into the estuary if it's already present there? Surely it's moot.
In the Dee estuary, there's cockle beds as well. I think they're over towards the Welsh side. And we believe that natural whales or those overseeing the Dee also have concerns of what else might be in the lake. So this is where, again, we need the consultants who've got the expertise in all of this. But I take the point, he is. Yeah.
What we're hoping for the consultants to take back from them is there's two issues here. If we don't have to drain the lake, then we may not have to repair the damage around the outside, which would be a lot cheaper. So what we're trying to do is get the experts in. They may take samples from sediment, they may take samples from the dee, and then they may help us negotiate with the regulators to say, well, you know what, I think the world should be allowed to do this, but we're going to need these experts in that day. So I think this, we just haven't got that expertise in-house. We thrashed this through for hours, and we were hoping, you know, from going through members, that we'll take this all back, and at the next stage of procurement, if we go to soft market testing, we're going to put this in, and hopefully come back to members with a suite of options, which is a bit more complicated than what we've got now, with a bit of a more informed position. If we empty the lake, it's definitely going to cost us. Because what Neil's explained to me is, draining the lake's okay, but as you fill it in, the actual damaged asphalt lining will be significantly damaged and folded. So what you're going to have to do is empty it again and do the repairs. So we need to feed that into the process. So not emptying the lake will be a lot cheaper.
That's great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. I'm just following on, Mike, in terms of where we are at the present moment in time. You just mentioned the fact that about the DS. So we take the DS, that's been polluted, if you like, with things for years and years and years. And it's worked its way down, it's down our way now. But what I can't understand is, how do you know, and who knows, who's responsible? The lake belongs to us, so you understand that. The Dee and the Welsh side, where does that come together? Because, at the end of the day, if that Dee is causing the problem, it's yours. Why are we paying for it?
I think the answer to that question is really not about where responsibility lies, but around the operations that are undertaken that are likely to damage the environmental interests of the Dee estuary.
Yes.
So we need to be careful that we need to do things properly, so that if our activities, such as emptying the lake, or disposing of an invasive species, or disposing of sand that we've dredged from the lake bed, damages the environmental designations of the estuary, then effectively the regulators will be in a position to prosecute us. So it's not where it's come from, it's about the activities that we as a local authority undertake and making sure that they're done legally and appropriately.
It might be a stupid question this afternoon, but what would be the effect if the wall of the lake was subsequently built higher to stop the Dee coming in at a later stage?
That's a good question. it's actually at the optimum level at the moment to allow all those processes to happen.
Thank you.
Any more comments, questions? David, do you want to take a few words?
Just a couple of comments, Chair. I mean, it's happening that everybody seems to be in support of doing something, but it's really special and unique. Like I said, it will be more complicated than the 2009 operation for the reasons that we've given, which was really just to empty the lake and get the heavy planting and shift the sand out. The only other big amount of water we should have previously I was involved in the Birkenhead Park scheme where we drained all those lakes and took all the silt out of there. That again was very straightforward. It all went to Junction 1 of the motorway. All those trees that were planted into the side of the queue were all planted on that silt. So this is a much more complicated operation. The handling thing is that Colin has already been doing posters, got his head around this and was making it happen. Neil has very good relationships with all the existing bodies anyway, all the bodies we have to liaise with. And Mike has very good relationships with the private service, because Mike and I have been I have to do with Mike to go and talk to them about their charges and fees, and it's obvious they have a really good relationship with them. So the key relationships are in place to make this happen. It is complicated by things like the Wilson Trophy and so on. It's also complicated by the bird nesting season and things like that. And clearly you've got a relationship to work with that. So it will be a complicated scheme. Some of the work that was done in 2009 has stood up really well because the walkway surface was renewed and so on, and that's actually still the test of time. It's the pitch that was poured into the stonework to hold the side of the walkway that goes into the lake, which is the number problem if you can take the water out. So I think all the ingredients are there to solve this. Clearly at some point there will need to be a capital bid come to members for the amounts that will need to be done and the time will need to fit in and keep it.
Thank you. Does the committee have any further comments or recommendations? Being on the committee and throwing them on is to get on with this as soon as possible. That's the feeling. Is that agreed?
Perfect.
Thank you. Item number 7 is use of glyphosate for weed control. We've got Colin Clayton Black, Mike Fairburn, and Andy Carlton. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present this report on the Council's use of glyphosate and our proposed measures to reduce its use. In the report we've outlined that we propose to eliminate the use of glyphosate in some areas where it may be possible. However, in the short term, the report accepts or outlines the continued use of glyphosate will still be necessary if we're to maintain the standards of weed control in the border that our residents and members clearly expect. Within the report, I've provided information to members on the current legality of the product, potential harm of glyphosate, and how we currently manage the risks of this product. In the report, we've provided to members the details of the current challenge of withdrawing glyphosate, the work we've done so far to find alternatives, and the discussions we've held with our colleagues across Merseyside, Cheshire, and some other authorities across the nation who are trying to find good practice and what they're getting as well. In terms of some positive steps, from December 2019, we're going to trial for 12 months the complete non-use of glyphosate in our parks, play areas, and crematoriums. There will be some exemptions, maybe to some of these species like Japanese knotweed, etc. We will look to report back the trial in 12 months. Some of our concerns about the damage potentially might be to the infrastructure is not being able to treat it as thoroughly as we are at the moment. Already the use of glyphosate has been reduced within the service, and we've spent about £6,000 less in this financial year than we did last year. I hope the report brings together some of the conclusions of the complexities we are going to face in
Yeah, you mentioned in the report about palm oil within the actual product used, which I was a bit concerned about, maybe down to the environment. So I made a few inquiries with the actual company that provides the actual downstream product. And basically, they said to me that it was overstated, the fact that the palm oil was there. It's not an ingredient, it's actually a cross-contamination in the actual, I think it's from coconut oil that is in the product. And it's a bit like what you're saying, that you've got a bar of chocolate that says Cadbury's Dairy Milk, it always there for making say nuts. It may not contain nuts, but they cover themselves in case of cross-contamination. So I don't really think the palm oil, I think it's a bit of a red herring really, the palm oil aspect of it, which I wanted to mention. And the other thing that in the report, I was a little bit disappointed really about that there wasn't anything regards a more holistic approach to steam, because there is a saturated steam method of weed control, which is very good, costs a lot cheaper and is more suitable for certain circumstances in certain areas of actual trying to clear the weeds. And I was hoping that you could perhaps come back after looking into steam control and provide me some links if you wish, so that UK companies that actually do, you know, large industrial scale steam cleaning of the same type of weeds which the foam stream could do. And that's all I'll ask you if I could think about that.
I'll bring Stephen in and I'll kind of answer some of these. I think it's a good point about palm oil, and perhaps we could have expanded on that a little bit. In terms of the actual machinery that Steve looked at as well, there was other operational limitations with that, but I'm certainly happy to go back and look at that product. It was just a concern that we wanted to raise to members. I'm sorry if we've overstated it, given the climate emergency and something once the company, they were a little bit reluctant, to be honest with you, to tell us the product. We had to push them a little bit, and it was only at the very end of the demonstration they said it's got palm oil, so they also highlighted to members. But the actual operation of the machinery had some logistical problems. I will bring Stephen to mention that, but in terms of the water steam, we couldn't get a demonstration before the committee. It's arranged for January, and I think it's a good idea for us to pursue. I think in the report we've asked for another 12 months to start going through some of these, but I think that could potentially be a machine that would work. Steve just kind of today to me, obviously, when he showed me the catalogues that this might be, but the one would be the one that we referred to before. Do you mind if I just ask Steve to describe what happened with the demo and why you thought that might have some difficulty, please?
Thank you. Evening, everyone. We trialled the hot foam at Braybridge Cemetery on the hard surface, and the results were good. And it was just only while I was there on my own with the representative of the company, and he mentioned palm oil, which sort of took me back a little bit because of all that publicity of palm oil. So I went away anyway, then I got back in touch with him, and you're right, Councillor, he said exactly the same to me as what he said to yourself. However, they have said that there is olive oil, an olive oil additive, I think that they can guarantee that there's no palm oil in it, but it's a, like, I think he said, a 15% uplift on that. Going on to the steam.
Could you just describe some of the actual demonstration, what happened, and why you thought it was so the streams,
Sorry. My main involvement is out on the streets, and the machine that he brought was on the back of a tipper wagon. They didn't have any bigger model, so that's what we would have to use. The extent of the hose was only about 30 metres, so I'm thinking in the middle, down the middle of a dual carriageway, say fender, would that work? We'd have to go traffic management, which would increase the cost. And I just didn't feel that was appropriate for out on the wider pavements. It was working parts, and I think I've said that it will work in parks and cemeteries. But out on the wider highway network, I don't think it would work.
saying that, the hot steam, we've got a demonstration. Well, he's got to come back with the date for me, and it's a machine that they use over in Denmark, I think it is, that they're using, and it's a water cracked. It's like a multi-hot unit with a boom spray on the top. But just to clarify, that will only do about 20,000 to 30,000 square meters a day. We've got 4.2 million square meters out on the highway. So for one of those machines, it would take to get round the whole of the borough, one of them machines would cost. It would take about 200 working days to get round with one operative, and that does not come cheap. That machine itself is £227,000 per machine. And then you've got the labour on top, the water, because it uses each tank. The tank holds 800 litres, and that 800 litres lasts for continual use for only 15 minutes. So you've got to fill that barrel up 24 times a day, and we'd have to use stamp frame to get it out. We'd only get about 6 hours use a day out of an eight hour day by the time you're stopping and filling your the operative's lunch. And that's so the water alone a year would cost us about 8,000. I think it was sort of the water alone would be just over 8,000. The labour for the 34 weeks that we treat the weeds. So in all, for that one unit, would be about £250,000, and that's an initial layout. And but to do it for 6 weeks, which we recommend, because the regrowth is going to come back after 6 weeks, we'd need about 5 of those machines. So in total, an initial layout would be about 1.5 million, and then about 130,000 every year after for labour and water, and that's without.
I'm not sure whether they're
electric or petrol.
Yeah, thank you for that. I do appreciate this logistical sort of things at the moment. The thing is that we're sort of like beginning with that sort of industry, really. You know, there's only a couple of companies in this country that have to be doing, so there's little competition, so obviously costs are high. There is a lot more in the States and Canada where there are entire cities that are actually serviced with alkaline tanks. I just feel that, only this month, I mean, there's been a class action in Canada for about £500 million against Glyphosate, and I fully expect in sort of end of 2022 the EU will probably ban it. So I think in the meantime, there'll be lots of companies looking at this sort of thing and coming along, and I do expect costs to become cheaper as there is more competition. That's really the only point I really have to make on that. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's, you know, there's only a couple out there in the market, and the prices are going to be higher than ones. But the more people get used to the glyphosate not being used, the government, hopefully the competition will be greater, prices should fall down.
Thank you. Just before we Jenny, just a question on the steam method. The fuel packs, what is used in those fuel packs? You mentioned.
Sorry.
The methods you just outlined, what are the fuel packs that produce the steam?
It doesn't. On the information I've been given, it doesn't mention. On the information I've been given, it doesn't actually say what, and that's why I said I'm not sure whether it's electric.
I think it's propylene, is it, or butane?
Sorry, Chair, I think we did have enough information at the time to put it into report. Sorry, a bit
scared. I'm just trying to make the point with, you know, declaring the climate emergency. Cleaner alternatives might not be so clean and environmentally friendly.
Sorry, butane. Referred to, there was another demonstration that we had, not by this.
moment, and you're obviously working very hard to examine alternatives. But with recommendation three, I'd like to know specifically who made that decision, when was it made, and is it in the cabinet remit, please?
I think what Councillor Johnson's referring to is that recommendation three is that the members were the note that a 12-month trial has ceased in glyphosate use, and he made those decisions.
Sorry, it's our kind of our recommendation as officers. So in terms of note that a 12-month trial, we're referring to our trial proposing parks, play areas and cemeteries. So we're going to stop that immediately. As part of our, we're asking you to accept that recommendation. Is that okay, Chair?
Is that what you're asking, Councillor Johnson?
Well, from my perspective, I'm saying you have not yet found a viable alternative. It still sounds like you're doing an awful lot of investigatory work. My question really was who. So that's not yet a decision. It's a recommendation from you, rather than a cabinet recommendation. So, yeah.
That's correct, Councillor. What we're proposing is that we've had some discussions internally with the management team, and we believe that we can trial it and manage the actual weed growth in parks, cemeteries and play areas. We couldn't offer anything more on the highways because we don't believe we can control the standards. It's probably a little bit easier in parks and countryside and more open as well. That's what we'd like to do. And then come back in 12 months. I think one of the risks of this is that as the weeds grow and start damaging the pavements and the tarmac, etc., then we may have to come back and say the trial has actually caused quite a bit of damage and we're going to have to find another alternative. Is that okay?
Yeah. In that then, I would say recommendation three, you outline which areas that you want to specifically commence that in. That would be really helpful, please. That's not there, so the parts, there as crematoriums. And also, you decided not to include the management of Willow Beach. I want to know why that was the case as well, please.
The Willow Beach is a completely separate matter. In terms of, you know, we proposed to look at the use of glyphosate, which we use generally across the board for weed control. So it's a completely separate matter, Councillor.
Thank you, Chair. I've had some evidence reports that the weeds can be removed by hand as a piffer. We've got renewed the contract, or have I got that from somewhere else? Did you just enlarge on that?
Would you like to comment? Sorry, Chair.
Could I just ask Andy McCormick on this, because he's been advising and working with us on this.
Okay, Chair, yeah, thank you.
Thanks, members. It's within the BIFA contract, the requirements are to remove dead weeds, so that's weeds that have already been sprayed by man-COVID. However, as part of, you know, Colin referred to the fact that this isn't going to be a single solution, this is going to be a combination of stopping in some areas like parks and things, foam, steam, and whatever else. Conversations are being had with BIFA to say, look, you know, as part of your street cleansing operations, can you consider in some areas, so maybe town centres and things like that, actually just hoeing them out as you're going past doing your routine cleansing? So the conversation with BIFA is just part of that overall mix.
I'm actually going back to probably by Jenny. We're talking about general use of glyphosate within the borough, which does include Hoylake Beach, and I still think that should be part of this report. Is we're looking at glyphosate, we're looking at alternatives, but in the meantime we haven't got anything at the moment, so we need to be looking at how we can use that to the best ability. And as someone who's actually used it and had to do the training, I know it's quite intense. So it is our staff are safe because they're wearing the appropriate PPE. But we need to be aware that it is part of the beach is part of the borough-wide use of glyphosate. I think it should be used to be part of this report.
Point at which we will be bringing an options paper to members in the future. Currently, we're working with Natural England to develop some options, and those options will be developed with consideration of a whole range of things other than glyphosate. And it is completely a separate issue in terms of who's going to be involved, who's going to look at the matter, and who I need to speak with. What we have, I have written to Natural England. We have got a meeting arranged for them. And we really need them as a regulatory body to advise us on how we go forward.
That's great, that's fine. And I'll say, this will be very similar to what Jenny said about the remake. I hope the councillors who involved within the area, the wards, are actually fully involved in the consultation of this, because I think we need to take into view the residents and the councillors.
I totally agree. I've had a lot of correspondence from both sides recently. There's a very strong feeling. I think it's absolutely critical we take into consideration all views, ward members, councillors, and that will be my intention to take that forward. It's just this initial step, a need to get us here from Natural England in order to see how the options can be developed. So I'm just asking for a little bit of time to do this, please. Thank you.
Okay, before I bring in our complaints.
Sorry for comments, to add to Brian's comments. The beach is a separate issue. I attended a public meeting in August in Norwich, so I'm aware of the views and fed that back. We did carry out the full spray of the beach, which we're allowed to do with the current arrangement. And as Colin says, he and I are working on a paper that will bring forward a whole range of options, a whole range of background about the beach. And we'll be doing that as soon as possible. And that will send out for members and it will include local.
Thank you, Jeff. It's just a quick request for information, really. How did we control weeds on pavements historically?
I was going to answer, but actually I'm going to leave the expert. It's a systemic one that changed, but I think it's right that Steve Mayer has been dealing with this for a long time.
Up to before 2000, we were able to use residual weed killers, which sat into the soil. So as the weed germinated, that would kill that at that stage. But those have actually been banned. So that's why it's just glyphosate now. Glyphosate will only kill what it touches, whereas if we sprayed the road one day, the next day we germinated, that would stay there until the next time around.
Is there any more? Going to the recommendation then, just from the discussion tonight, I don't think there is a viable alternative that's been found at the moment, so I would like to alter, might not get a second, but I would like to propose that we alter recommendation number 3 to glyphosate use to be continued until a viable option is identified. Do I have a second of that?
I'll second that, sure.
Thank you. All those in, do I think,
sorry, Chair, are you suggesting therefore that experiments in the parks and so forth will not go ahead?
Yes. And what I'm suggesting is just changing that third point, that we continue to use glyphosate until a viable alternative is found. Come on, so perfectly fine. Yes, Tony.
Chair, on the Meat Streets project, the weeds are being cleared physically. Glyphosate isn't being used at all. I'm sure that can continue. Should continue. Meat Streets working in conjunction with Biffa and Magenta on the clearing the weeds out of the alleyways.
Sure, I'm talking about everywhere else. So, if you read the recommendation, it says that. That a 12-month trial ceasing glyphosate use in some settings will commence. I don't think there's an alternative, so I'm just putting a recommendation that it continues until a viable alternative is available. I've just had a second bit. Is there any other amendments to it?
Can I just ask a quick question?
Yes.
The way I see it is that unless you do the trial, you don't know if there is a viable alternative.
So all those in favour of my recommendation? All those against? That's clearly lost. All those in favour of the original recommendation? All those against? The original recommendation stands.
You want to go under specific settings, but it says in some settings you want to go this the area.
That'll be really helpful.
In terms of where the specific settings would be, I think they in section 3.17 with the sites, parks, play areas and cemeteries was my understanding of where it was being suggested it might be priority, which so it's minimising, we do everything that we can try to do already. So it's a bit like just sort of carrying that process of minimisation in parks, play areas and cemeteries as far as it can do, which is one of the things we seek to do. So in terms of being somewhere where it can be piloted, that's...
Okay, thank you for that comment. Moving on to item 8, the board of two rural plant performance. Thank you. I don't propose, with all that report, do we have any questions for David? Or anybody else itself? No, any questions on? Okay.
I'd just like to say that I think it's impossible to read some of the detail in these reports on these laptops. I don't know if there's any way they could be sort of formulated so they're a little bit more readable. But the way they go across, the way they do, it's just impossible to read, to be honest.
We'll take that. Thank you. So can we note that report? The work programme update, as outlined, has just been there's been one. The tree policy task and finish group is still ongoing. We are looking to have another meeting around the 13th of January. The original date is around the 21st of January. The allotment provision that was asked to be put on the report for tonight wasn't possible, unfortunately, so that will roll over to the next committee. Is there any other comments or questions, any additions to the work programme that members want to make now?
Just briefly on the tree policy, there will be a briefing coming out from the mining members next week about where we are up to post the inquest, post the fatality. That's a separate process to this, so hopefully early next week we'll get a briefing that tells you where, gives you the context of that, tells you where we are currently, and tells you what the next steps are. That is separate to this.
So Tony, onto the first.
Thank you, Chair. There was a question asked of full council regarding the possible harmful effects of 5G on adults, on humans and the environment. The recommendation was for that to go to environment, adults and children's scrutiny. Is that on the programme?
Yeah, Tony, so on page 88, it's
future
items to schedule 5G. Jenny, did you have a question?
Just on the trees, has trees and friends operators of the individual parks are all consulted and all advised about the tree situation as well, please, because some of them are being excluded at the moment. Thank you.
We can try to do that. I think Colin's already outlined that because of resources, it's a bit of a struggle. I can reassure members that the current maintenance that we're dealing with will not continue at the current rate. We're hoping to conclude this site of work early next year, and then we'll move into a much more modest maintenance.
groups can feed into that, and also they can feed into more of you if you want to email me those comments, but just that might be helpful if you want to learn those.
I appreciate the resources, but at the same time, I think an email to all friends of groups would be really helpful, please. That doesn't take a lot of time or resource. I hope thing I'd ask as well is that we do look at bats as well. There's been a lot of concerns about bats and being resident in the trees and potentially doing damage to them, so we need to be aware of our obligations, legal obligations, in relation to bats as well, please.
Again, yes, Chair, we have been working with friends groups. I know the most recent case that we're aware of, which I think is the Grange, I went there myself on Tuesday morning to see what's going on, looked into it. You take another example from West Kirby. We've worked well with the friends group in Ashton Park, who clearly are sad to see some of the trees go, but they understand the reasons why. We're going to work with them about replanting to put more suitable trees in other places. So it isn't, we haven't been doing it, it's just the sheer volume of trying to do it. No, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'll just take this opportunity to catch David on what he's just said there about replanting trees that have been removed. There's been a long history of trees getting removed from the verges, which never been replaced. Are we looking at replacing them as well at the same time?
I think what we're looking at is bidding wherever we can for investment to replant. I think in terms of highway trees, clearly again it needs to be the right tree in the right place. You know, I used an example this afternoon. I'm sure those people, the generations before us, would not have planted some of the trees they planted next to roads if they could have visualised what would be driving along those roads these days. I think it does need careful scrutiny. I think we will replant in highways where it's appropriate, and we will replant wherever else we can, where it's appropriate. Really, we do have some trees that we don't plan to take out if they're healthy, but they are the wrong trees in the wrong places.
Lesley?
Thank you. Just a very quick one, really. I just recall
us
from Lambury, but we had a recent meeting of the leaders and deputies with Mike, very kindly went through the forestry truth strategy with us. I did mention at that point, and it really goes on to what my colleague Jenny Johnson said about liaising with various interested groups, because I'm sure it happened in other areas of the borough, but clearly in my ward in Wallasey, there are a number of residential rooms where trees were planted, which is clearly, you know, they are way above even the properties in those roads. But some time ago, when they were planted, there was an agreement between the residents.